Okay, hello there. Doing a review today of a album which came out a week ago, I think now. McCartney 3. So I've already done a video of my first impressions of it. I've listened to it quite a lot since then. So yeah, I feel I'm now ready to do my proper review of this. So anyway, before we get into it, we'll get into the album background first, which I'm not going to speak at all throughout this background, so yeah. I'll see you in a bit.
Now, does this mean a business or emotional split within the Beatles?
I should think a bit of both. But I think it's more of a break. He answers himself that he doesn't know whether it's temporary or permanent. That's the truth. I think none of us know that.
More guitar. Just kind of continuing, and if it comes out a bit like the Beatles, I don't think it will, but if it did, it wouldn't worry me, you know. It's a pretty good band.
Sometime, maybe.
What do you think about marijuana?
It was a big mistake.
Oh, will you try to come back to Japan?
Yes, I will try.
Okay. Were you well treated while you were here? Were you well treated?
Yeah, very well.
What's happened to Wings?
When I recorded this, that was last summer of 79. Since then, we played a British tour with Wings. And then we were scheduled to go to Japan, but I had a spot of bother there, and that didn't come off. So since then, actually, I've just been getting this album finished and releasing that, and I think Denny's doing his own solo stuff. So we're taking a bit of breather with Wings and deciding what we want to do next rather than kind of just rush into anything for the sake of it.
Bye. every night I just want to go out, get out of my head. Every day I don't want to get up, get out of my bed.
Health Organization has officially called it COVID-19. Co for corona, vi for virus, d for disease, and 19 because it started last year. The name, though, of course, isn't the most pressing concern. On Monday in China, it suffered its highest number of deaths in one day.
And it's clear that coronavirus COVID-19 continues and will continue to spread across the world and our country over the next few months. From this evening, I must give the British people a very simple instruction. You must stay at home.
I don't care to be bad. I prefer to think twice. All I know is it's quite a show, but it's still all right to be nice. Yankee toes and Eskimos can turn to frozen ice when the cold days come.
Right, so there's the background. We'll now get into a track-by-track review. First things first, I'll show you again just in case you didn't see my first impressions video. That's the front cover, that's the back cover. Not that anyone might have seen this yet. That's the gatefold. I've got the blue vinyl, I won't get it out, can't be bothered. I've got this new stand here which I shall sit the album on like that. Oh, very professional. I've also got this version of Paul's official store. The red version, which has a different back cover. I've not opened it yet. Yeah, I maybe will. So, yeah. So, McCartney 3. This is Paul's first number one album since Flowers in the Dirt. Whether it's his most deserving number one album since Flowers in the Dirt is debatable. I still think Flaming Pie is his best album of recent years. If you can call 1997 recent. But in terms of Paul's last few albums, New and Egypt Station, I personally think this is a better album than both of them. I know there's a lot of people out there who love New, and there's a lot of people that love Egypt Station. But especially New, I know that's held in quite high regard amongst us Paul fans. But what I like about this album is Paul's producing it. You know, with New and Egypt Station, Paul is working with a quite in producer, like Flavour of the Month. You know, New, he's got Mark Ronson on it and others that I can't remember. There's quite a lot of producers on New. On Egypt Station, he has Greg Kirsten and Ryan Tedder working on it. So they try to take him down like a contemporary path, which isn't a bad thing in some ways. In other ways it is, but yeah. But on this album, there's none of that. It's, yeah, it's just Paul being Paul, doing what Paul wants to do. So if you see my review of McCartney 2, which I will, in fact I'll link my reviews of McCartney 1 and 2 in the description down below, then you'll have seen, I said in my McCartney 2 review that, this was in April this year, that Paul would never do an album like this anymore. And I'm going to try and defend my comment now, because obviously he has. What I meant by that comment was like an experimental album where people will go, oh, that doesn't really sound like Paul McCartney, that. Which is what McCartney 2 is. There's none of that on here. It does sound like Paul McCartney, which isn't a bad thing, by the way. But, it's, you know, it's very Paul McCartney, you know. I stopped doing that. I did that in my first impression as well. I'll stop doing that, you know, terrible impression, you know. So yeah, that's what's... I forgot what I was saying now. There we go. I've lost my train of thought already. So what else did I want to say? Yes, unlike McCartney 1 and 2, however, Paul has got working with engineers on this. On McCartney 1 and 2, Paul engineered that as well as produced and written and played every instrument and everything. And he doesn't play every instrument on this. On, you know, there's a one track where there's other musicians on it, which I'll get to. And it also has Greg Kirsten co-producing on Sliding and George Martin co-producing on When Winter Comes. Anyway, so if I'd done this review the day it came out, this is why I wanted to wait, I'd have gone, "Wow, this is the best album Paul's done since Flaming Pie, blah, 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 it's one of his best albums." It's sunk in now, and I don't think it's one of his strongest albums. I wouldn't put it amongst his very best. It's definitely a good album, however, and I do prefer it to New and Egypt Station, personally. But yeah, I think some of the tracks are stronger than others. There's some tracks that are a bit on this album. There's a sound to, if you know what that sound means. Something I will also say is the vinyl track listing differs from the standard one, CD and digital and streaming and whatnot. Why you didn't change it on the digital and standard versions, I don't know, so that it was the same across all of them, but the reason he's done it on here is to get the length, running length on each side of the vinyl even, obviously. Anyway, I'm rambling, so I'll get into the track by track review. It opens with Long-Tailed Winter Bird, which is an instrumental. It's a very good instrumental, really good guitar work on this. Very catchy, play it loud, really like it. However, this is like 5.5 minutes long. Personally, I think it's a bit too long. I wish he'd sliced it a bit and maybe made about 3.5 minutes. After that, it kind of gets a bit repetitive. But yeah, the instrumentation's on here. And I'm pleased it's an instrumental because McCartney 1 and 2 both had instrumentals on. But I did think when this originally got announced that there wouldn't be instrumentals on this. But this is the only one. And it's a good one. Yeah, really good tune. Really like Long-Tailed Winter Bird. It was also the first song that we heard when this album was revealed back in October in that little teaser trailer. And when I first heard it, I was a bit worried for this album because the Do You Miss Me bit, which is, there is a little bit of lyrics in this, but it's predominantly an instrumental. When I first heard it, I thought, oh dear, that doesn't sound great. But for some reason in that teaser trailer, Paul seems to have put his vocals much higher in the mix of that, but in this it seems buried quite deeper in the mix, so you can't really hear his voice, his age, that clearly. Not that I won't mention his voice a couple of times, but I'll do it now. Obviously Paul is now 78. He doesn't sound like how he did at 28, you know, so he's not going to be reaching those high notes of like Oh Darling and Monkberry Moon Delight and Live and Let Die and even The Pound Is Sinking off Tug of War. That was a good vocal. But yeah, I don't personally think his vocals are that bad on this album. Yeah, in fact, there's not many tracks where I kind of was that bothered about his vocals. I think they're all right for most of it. Anyway, the next track after Long-Tailed Winter Bird is Find My Way. There was no singles from this album released before it came out. However, on the day it came out, on December 18th, this was released as a single. And obviously, if this had been... this could have been the single in advance. It's the logical track to be a single. It's a really good tune, Find My Way. I really like it. Good instrumentation, yeah, I'll say. What is incredible about this album is pretty much every sound you hear on it is coming from Paul. He's an amazing man. He's, you know, very talented, you know. But yeah, this one, I quite like the vocals, especially on the chorus when it goes a bit more high-pitched. I think it sounds all right, to be honest. You never used to be afraid of days like this. Now you're overwhelmed by your anxieties. Arguably, that could be written about these COVID times that we find ourselves in. But yeah, good tune. Really catchy. Really like it. Pretty Boys comes next. So this one, it's all right. It's an acoustic thing. It sounds like it's Paul sort of, he said it's about male models. What it sounds like is it's kind of him looking at the current youth culture of everyone taking photos of themselves and stuff. which arguably I'm guilty for as well. But, you know, it is. It's a catchy little tune. I don't think it's the strongest on the album, but yeah, it's an alright tune. Women and Wives comes next. If you see my first impressions video, you'll have seen me say that I didn't particularly like this tune. It has grown on me. Paul has said quite a few times it's his favourite song on the album. I wouldn't say it's mine. I still wouldn't say it's one of my favourites. I think this is perhaps the one where Paul's voice sounds oldest, maybe. It was the only one when I first listened to this album where I thought, his voice sounds a bit crap on this. It doesn't sound as bad as it carry as it gets going, the song, but when it first starts, I thought, oh dear. Yeah. Lyrics are good, though. I've heard some people say it sounds a bit like a later day Johnny Cash song, a bit like Hurt and all that stuff from that era. And yeah, I could actually imagine Johnny Cash singing this. Obviously, he'd do it more acoustically than like this is a piano ballad. But yeah, it's an alright tune. Not the greatest he's ever done, I don't think, but yeah, it's alright. Lavatory Lil comes next. So this has been compared to the likes of Polyphene Pam off Abbey Road. Yeah, good tune. Really like the backing vocals on this, where Paul answers himself. Once again, it's Paul doing his own backing vocals, so, you know, he's singing along with himself, which is a funny thought. But the big question with this song is, who is it about? You think she's being friendly, but she's looking for a Bentley. The obvious thing people will jump to is Wonky Leg, Heather Mills. But yeah, I mean, it's like, what, 12 years or something now since they split up? So whether it is, I don't know. Could be. It's the logical thing, but then, of course, Paul's youngest daughter, Beatrice, is with Heather, so is he really going to slag off his youngest daughter's mother? Doesn't stop her slagging Paul off, though. But Paul's the bigger man. Anyway, yeah, good tune. Really like Lavatory Lil. Sliding comes next, so obviously on the vinyl, it's different from the that one, the CD and everything else. So Sliding, this song features Rusty and Abe out of Paul's band on it, which to me is a problem, because this is a McCartney album and the whole thing is it's supposed to be Paul on his own, but this song isn't Paul on his own. I think it's a leftover track from Egypt Station that wasn't finished and then Paul's finished it off. I'd rather he'd re-recorded it personally with him doing the instruments, but whatever. It's a good song, but yeah, it is. It's a really good song, but I just don't feel it should be on this album, personally. So I've seen a review of this album where someone said that this sounds a bit like Arctic Monkeys, a bit like something that would be on AM. And it does. It really does with the instrumentation. And I really like the vocals on here. Paul's kind of trying to do that Helter Skelter style, but obviously he's limited now because he's 78. But yeah, it's a really good vocal. I think it's a really good song. Yeah, it's a real good rocker, real heavy rocker. Yeah, good tune, I like Sliding. Deep, Deep Feeling comes next. So this one is like 8 minutes long. And it seems to be like Marmite, this song. People either seem to love it or hate it. I was a bit on the fence about it when I first heard it. I'm starting to move more in towards the love it thing. It's very indulgent. It does sound like Paul indulging. Being self-indulgent. Yeah, it's a bit like Secret Friend, which was the B-side to Temporary Secretary, I think, from McCartney 2 Sessions. That's the longest thing he's ever done. It's like over 10 minutes, that. It's a really nice bit of instrumentation, but it just goes on and on and on, and this song's a bit like that. But then I don't know if it would be this, if it would work as well if it was shortened. But yeah, it's the lyrics are really good. They're really good lyrics, I think. The instrumentation, it's good, but it just seems to go on a bit. But it's also part of its charm, the way it goes on and on. Yeah, I like it, I do. I think it's still growing on me, but I think we'll get to the point in maybe a few months time where I love this song. But yeah, it's still growing on me, this. Kiss of Venus comes next. After the reveal trailer, which had Long-Tailed Winterbird, then I think maybe 3 or 4 weeks before the album came out, we got another trailer which had this song, Kiss of Venus. And Yeah, I really like this tune. This is classic McCartney. This is very much like something you would get on the first McCartney album. It sounds a bit like Junk, with a bit of Put It There, off Flowers and Dirt, and Venus and Mars thrown in. Yeah, it's a really good tune. I believe it's inspired by a book that Jules Holland's wife gave Paul. Yeah, it's a real nice instrumentation on this, real good guitar. Sounds, you know, vocal, Paul's trying to do his high set, or yeah, that's the right word, isn't it? Yeah, it's very high pitched anyway, which I think sounds really good actually. I was a bit worried when I first heard the trailer thing, but yeah, it's grown on me, to be honest, and I actually think it's quite a good vocal, personally. Right, after that, Seize the Day. This is my favourite track on the album. Some people have said it sounds Beatly, some people say it doesn't. I think it does, personally, sound quite Beatly. Yeah, again, great instrumentation on here. I don't care to be bad, I prefer to think twice. All I know is it's quite a show, but it's still alright to be nice. Quite a nice lyric. What it's kind of saying is that we should hold on to the day, seize the day, not think into the future, but just appreciate the day that we're currently in, the present. It's kind of like reflecting on these COVID times, you know. Yeah, but it's a good tune. I really like it. It's really catchy. Best on the album, in my opinion. So Deep Down is next. A lot of people don't like this song. I quite like it. However, similarly to Long Tailed Winter Bird and Deep Deep Feeling, I think it goes on too long. You should have shortened this. It's very catchy. It's one of those songs where you're sort of like clapping along like that. Yeah, nice tune. Quite modern, but I don't think it's his best song he's ever done. It's not the best on the album, but yeah, I like it. Good tune. Good tune, isn't it? And then after that, we have the closing track of the album, Winter Bird, When Winter Comes. So it starts off with a reprise of Long Tailed Winter Bird, which again, lovely instrumental. And then it kicks into When Winter Comes, which, yeah, it's a bit of a tone change. It doesn't really flow that well into it. Anyway, before this album came out, it leaked online. A lot of people heard the leaks. I didn't, but I did hear one track, and it was this track. And if you're only going to hear one track off this album, this probably isn't the best one to hear, because I heard it, and I heard the vocals, and I thought, how the hell has he done that? He sounds like Paul again. Well, not that that's a bad way of phrasing it, but he sounds like young Paul again, like the Paul voice we think of when we think of Paul McCartney. And I was really impressed. I thought, oh, God, this is going to be great, this album. And then I found out that this song was recorded in 1992. And obviously in 1992, nobody was complaining about Paul's voice. So it turns out, 3rd of September 1992, we know this was recorded, when he was working with George Martin recording Calico Skies and Great Day for Flaming Pie, it turns out there was a third song, which was this song. But yeah, he never finished it and never released it. Don't know why, because it's a great tune. Contender for best on the album. It sounds like something that would be on the first McCartney album, or Ram, or Wildlife. You know, it sounds like the days when Paul and Linda were living up on Highgate Farm, up on Mullaghcentire. And it sounds like Paul had a to-do list of jobs he needs to do on the farm, and he's just singing his to-do list whilst playing his acoustic guitar. It's a beautiful tune. It's classic McCartney. It's a great way to close the album. But whether it should be on this album or not is debated. I believe it was going to go on the archive edition of Flaming Pie, but he left it off because he thought it was too good and put it on here. Now, I don't know if he's done anything to this song, because obviously we haven't heard the original, whether he's added more instruments or re-recorded the guitar or whatever, but he has definitely not done anything with the vocals, because this is not a recent vocal from Paul, which, you know, it kind of does. The reason it doesn't fit is because of that. His voice doesn't fit with the rest of the album. It's old Paul for the rest of the album, whereas, well, he's 50 on this song, whereas he's 78 on every track on this album, with the exception of this one, where he's 50. So he sounds like younger Paul, middle-aged Paul, I suppose he was at that point. But yeah, it's a great tune, it is. And it's just strange he's kept onto it for this long and not put it out. Anyway, that's it, McCartney 3. Yeah, I do think it is Paul's best album of the last decade, at least. Whether it's better than, it's definitely not better than Flaming Pie. Whether it's better than Chaos and Memory Almost Full, I don't know. But yeah, is it better than McCartney 1 and McCartney 2? I'm still trying to figure it out. It's definitely the most commercial and the most well-polished of the three. I do think it is worthy of being a McCartney album, with the exception of Sliding, which, in my opinion, it's a good tune, but it shouldn't be on this album. When Winter Comes, I think I said that George Martin co-produces that, which, you know, arguably, well, should that be on as well? But then again, I don't know if this should be on anyway because of his voice being too young for it. But yeah, overall, it's a pretty good album, I think, and it's, yeah, I'm really pleased we had it. You know, if there's one good thing that this virus malarkey has caused, it is this album, because I don't think we'd ever got McCartney 3 otherwise. So yeah, thank you, Paul. McCartney 4 soon, please. So anyway, yeah, I'll see you soon. Thank you very much for watching. Yeah, go listen to this number one album if you haven't heard it yet. So yeah, I'll see you soon. Ta-ra!